Let us start again. I will state the problem once more. R is a ring and 0 and multiplicative identity are unique. That is what we want to prove. What does it mean that the additive identity 0, if you always start like this, if 0 and 0 bar are two additive identities, then we want to prove that 0 and 0 bar are one and the same. That's very easy because both are additive identities. So 0 plus 0 bar is equal to 0 because 0 bar is an identity, and it is also equal to 0 bar because 0 is identity. So 0 and 0 bar are one and the same. Similarly, you can show that if 1 and 1 bar are two identities, then 1 and 1 bar are one and the same. So it was rather easy to prove this. We now go to the next basic idea of subring. You have studied groups, so you know what subgroups are. Exactly in the same way, for rings we also have subrings. So what will they be? They will be subsets of the ring which are also rings with the same operations. Let us state it. S contained in R with these ring operations is a subring if S with the same operations is a ring. So as a subset, it is also a ring with the same operations. And is there a rule for it? Yes. The easy rule is that if S is contained in R and A, B in S implies A minus B is also in S, then S is a subring of R. Does this remind you of something? Something that you learnt in group theory? Just remember that if G is a group and G1 is a subset of G, then G1 is a subgroup if A and B in G1 implies A B inverse also in G1. I want to remind you of this because that is precisely the thing that we are using here. For S to be a ring, what do you need? S should be an abelian group under addition. Under addition, if it is an abelian group, then A and B in S should imply that A minus B is also in S. Then by this rule, first of all, S is a subgroup. The abelian property follows because all the elements are in R, and in R addition is abelian anyway. So, with this property, shall we write down? Let us write down. Let us quickly write down the proof of this. A minus B is in S will imply that first of all S plus is abelian group. Then as far as the other properties, that is if A, B in S, consider A into B, and the distributive property, all those properties follow because S is a subset. If you are given a subset of R, how do you decide that the subset is a ring by itself?
Take any two elements in that subset and check if A minus B is in R or not. Now let us look at different examples of
We are looking at subrings. The first ring that we saw is the ring of integers. So what are the subrings contained in Z? What I say is for any integer m, mz is a subring of Z. You can check that, because if R and S are in mz, then R minus S is also in mz. Similarly, go further. N, M, Z is a subring of M, Z. Let us look at M2Z. Can you find subrings for M2Z? Yes. M2MZ, that is 2 by 2 matrices with elements in MZ, that is a subring of M2Z. Let us look at a finite ring now. Z6. What are the elements? 0 bar, that is the same as 6 bar. And 6 bar is same as 0 bar. So these are the elements. Now, just look at this subset to start with. Galien says, prove that this is a subring of Z6. Since there are only 3 elements, it is very easy to check that this is an abelian group under addition. 2 bar plus 2 bar is 4 bar. 4 bar plus 4 bar is 8, that is 2 bar again. 2 bar plus 4 bar is 0 bar. So, for any A and B, A minus B is also in the subset S. So, S is a subring. Now, does it have identity? Additive identity is 0 bar, of course. But what about multiplicative identity? Does it have multiplicative identity? Let us check. 2 bar into 2 bar is equal to 4 bar. But 2 bar into 4 bar is what? It is 2 bar. So, for 2 bar, 4 bar acts as identity. But then, it should also be identity for 4 bar itself. What is 4 bar into 4 bar? 16 is again 4 bar. So, when we examine the multiplication among elements, we realize that 4 bar is indeed a multiplicative identity for this subring. That is very interesting. Why? Because remember this example, it is going to be useful later as well. Z6 is a ring. It has identity, the usual identity 1 bar. S is a subring of Z6. You might think that S does not have identity because 1 bar is not there. But another element, 4 bar, acts as multiplicative identity for S. So, it's very interesting. S is also a ring with identity, and the identity of S is not the same as the identity in Z6, that is the parent ring. So this example is going to be very, very interesting later on as well. What about A? Commutative ring with unity and the subring does not have identity at all. We have already given the example. I just now wiped it because Z contains MZ, a subring commutative. The parent ring has identity but the subring has no identity. That also you are aware of. Let us now look at some problems given in Galien's book. And let us try to solve them. There are lots and lots of problems in Galien's book and in other books also. I invite the students to solve more and more problems. This is mathematics, and unless you solve at least some simple problems, you cannot really make progress. So please do try to solve some problems. I will be helping you in the class. And if you get stuck with a problem, You can always ask me and I can solve it in the class. I will now write down some problems from the book. Okay, that's it. So what is this set? This set is A plus B root 2, where A and B are contained in Z. Okay. Now, this is a ring. You can check that addition, multiplication follow all the rules that we have. Let us look at what is this contained in. This is contained in the ring of real numbers. Yes, that's very easy to see. The ring of real numbers is contained in the ring of complex numbers. So all this is a sequence of subrings. Now, let us look at problem 6. Problem number 6. Find an integer n such that the ring Zn does not have some special properties. What are they? Does not have the following. Let us examine one by one. This is the property. A square equal to A must imply that A is equal to 1 or A is equal to 0. Just let us look at this property alone, then we will check one by one. So what are we looking at? We are looking at integers modulo n. Let us write down. What is Zn? Zn is 1, 0 bar, 1 bar, and then n minus 1 bar, because n bar is same as 0 bar. Look at the property stated. What does it say? A square equal to A must imply that A is equal to 1 or A is equal to 0. So, Zn should have first of all 0 and 1. Yes, Zn does have 0 and 1. What do you associate this with? I am just trying to teach you how to solve different problems. What does this imply? A square equal to A is equivalent to, in fact, A into A minus 1 is equal to 0. You have been doing this. You have been doing this for many years. What does it mean? And the solution says that A is equal to 0 or A equal to 1. So, how do you interpret it? That means that this equation, together with the fact that Zn has no zero divisors, that will imply that A equal to 0 or A equal to 1. I hope you remember what this property means. I'll quickly write it for you. R has a zero divisor A if there exists B not equal to 0 such that AB is equal to 0. What is a zero divisor? Zero divisor is an element which has got another non-zero element so that the multiplication AB is 0. Now, R, if R has no zero divisors, then this equation will mean A equal to 0 or A equal to 1. So, what do we want? We want Zn which has zero divisors. Do you understand? Because if there are no zero divisors, then necessarily A will be 0 or A will be 1. So, can you think of examples of Zn so that Zn has zero divisors? Of course, consider Z6 for example. You know that 2 bar multiplied by 3 bar is 6 bar, that is 0 bar. So, Z6 has got 0 divisors. Many others. Z15, 3 bar into 5 bar is equal to 15 bar, that is 0 bar. So, let us look into the rings where you have zero divisors so that you can obtain A which is not 0 or 1 but A square is equal to A. Otherwise, you have no chance. Please understand again that if the ring has no zero divisors, then this property is necessarily true. So, look for a ring which has zero divisors and I think you will get an example. Look at Z6, 0 bar, 1 bar. Look at the squares, 1 square is square. Now, these are out because we do not want A, we do not want A to be 0 or 1. Look at 2, 2 square is 4, 3 square is 9 is 3, so we got an element. We have already seen that 4 square is also 4, 5 square is 1, so that doesn't help. But we know that 3 bar square is equal to 9 bar, that is 3 bar again. 4 bar square is equal to 16 bar, that is 4 bar again. So, here we have got two elements A and B. A square is equal to A, B square is equal to B, but A and B, none of them is 0 or 1. So, you have to study the statement properly, and the best policy in mathematics is that you have to consider different equivalent statements for a given statement. That helps you a lot because the given statement might look like something, but the equivalent statement can be more helpful in solving the problems. Let us look at some more. That second property in the same example, the same example 6, is that AB equal to 0 implies A equal to 0 or B equal to 0. We have already seen that for Z6 it is not satisfied. 2 bar into 3 bar is 0 bar, but neither 2 bar nor 3 bar is 0. So, this we have already got. The third property that is stated in the same problem is AB equal to AC and A not equal to 0 implies B equal to C. Can we get in Z6 now a solution for this? A not equal to 0, A B equal to AC, but B not equal to C. So what do you want to do? You have to construct the multiplication table. You have to construct the multiplication table and check all the multiplications by different residue classes, where AB will land you into AC, but B is not equal to C. Shall I leave you to do that? You need to write the multiplication table, or shall we do it? Zero bar we don't want. 1 bar, 2 bar. So, what do you get? So, this line is obvious. So is this one. Now, we hope to get what we want in the remaining multiplication table. This is then okay. Now, 4 bar into 4 bar is 16. So, this is the whole multiplication table. You can construct it for Z15 also, but it will take much longer time and a large paper as well. Can we get now solutions of AB equal to AC, A not equal to 0 and B not equal to C? AB into AC, just check. See, A should not be reversible. You don't want A to have an inverse. If A has a multiplicative inverse, you can multiply the equation and get B equal to C. That is the way you have to think. Because if A has got the multiplicative inverse, then necessarily B will be equal to C. So we have to find a solution of AB equal to AC where A does not have an inverse. So which doesn't have inverse? So these elements do not have inverses. 5 and 1 have got inverses. So, can you find an element now? Yes. See, 4 into 1 is 4 and 4 into 4 is also 4. But 1 is not 4. Take A to be equal to 4 bar, B equal to 1 bar and C equal to 4 bar again. Then you already know that 4 bar into 1 bar is equal to 4 bar into 4 bar, but 1 bar is not equal to 4 bar. So this is what I wanted you to check, but this is just an example so that you know how to solve the problems. Look at the statement again. AB equal to AC, A not equal to 0, and when does it imply that B equal to C? If A has got multiplicative inverse, then B will be equal to C. But we don't want it. We want an example where this is not satisfied. Therefore, we must choose A, B and C so that A does not have multiplicative inverse. That is why we chose 4 bar and we got the answer. You can also get it with 3 bar and 2 bar. Check. Okay. Now, the last part of the same problem says, is the n you found a prime? This in fact suggests something. What are the n's that we found? Z6 and Z15. In these rings, we can see that these rules are not satisfied. And these rings are with n, where n is composite. Okay? So, let me give you a new problem now. And I want you to try it. And let us know if you can solve. If P is a prime, then ZP is a ring with unity. It is commutative or abelian, it is the same thing. And every element A which is not 0, okay, if A is not the additive 0 in ZP or A is not 0 bar, then A has a multiplicative inverse. And ZP minus the 0 element is a group under multiplication. Okay? So, this is a simple exercise for you. If P is a prime, look at ZP. Show that it is a ring with unity, commutative, and every element A which is not 0, it has got a multiplicative inverse. And ZP minus 0 is a group under multiplication. If you don't see the dot, I'll write. Okay. Omit 0 from ZP and all the remaining elements, they form a group under multiplication. Okay. So, that is an extra exercise for you. And let us look at some other exercise from the book again. Show that I am looking at problem number 9. Show that a ring which is cyclic under addition is commutative. Let us write it down. If R is a ring cyclic under addition, then R is commutative. First, you need to understand the statement. Usually when you are thinking of cyclic groups, you are considering them under multiplication. So be careful. R is a ring cyclic under addition. What does that mean? We know that R plus is an abelian group. So concentrate only on R plus, because the first statement is concerned only with addition. So R plus is a cyclic group. It is abelian, but it is also cyclic. What does it mean? It means that it is generated by a single element A under addition. That is the definition of a cyclic group. If the cyclic group is generated by a single element, then it is cyclic. What do you mean by that? All other elements are written as A into A into A if it is multiplicative, but it is written in additive form. So what are all the other elements? So all the elements are either A plus A plus A m times or minus A minus A minus A m times. So what are they? They are m A, where m is in Z. Now what does that mean? R plus is cyclic under addition, so it is generated by a single element, and therefore R can be written as m A, where A is in R and m is in Z. Now it makes the matters easy. Every element in R is of this form. So take any two elements. If and S and A are two elements . So any two elements R and S will be written in this form, MA and NA. So what will be R into S? We want to show that capital R is commutative. That is, the multiplication of two elements, any two elements, is multiplicative. But what is this? This is MA into NA. This is equal to M into NA. And what is R into S? That is NM into A. So what do we have? R into S is MNA, and S into R, I'm sorry. I should have written this S into R. R into S is MNA and S into R is NMA. But where are M and N? M and N are in Z, and Z is commutative. Therefore, MN is equal to NM. Therefore, R into S and S into R are one and the same. Okay, so what did we do? We have shown that R is commutative. The multiplication is commutative in R. What did we use? We are given that R is cyclic under addition. And the property of being cyclic is very strong. Even though it is only the additive group that is cyclic, we came down to the properties of Z. Okay? R is an abstract ring. R is not a ring of integers. Please understand this. R is an abstract ring, but It is cyclic under addition. As soon as it is cyclic under addition, we know that every element can be expressed as m into a, that is a plus a m times. M can be positive or negative. If m is negative, what you are doing is you are adding minus a so many times. That is the additive inverse of a so many times. But m will still be in Z. If it is a finite cyclic group, then you know that these elements will be finite in number. If it is infinite cyclic group, you know that m can take all different values in Z because it is an infinite cyclic group. Then m will take all positive and negative values in Z. But any element will still be expressed as m into a where m is in Z. Whether it is a finite cyclic group or infinite doesn't matter. Then come down to two general elements, little r and little s, m a n a, and now the multiplication is reduced to multiplication of integers. And we know that the multiplication in integers is commutative. So we transferred the problem down to integers and it was easy to solve the problem eventually. Shall we look at another problem? We have at least 5 more minutes. So let me choose another problem and we will try to solve it. But I still want to stress the fact that I expect the students themselves to try and solve some of the problems. At least the simple ones you should be able to get. The difficult ones you can always ask your teacher, you can ask me by email and we will try to solve them in the class if they are really tough. Okay, there was at some place the problem of finding, the first example itself. Give an example of a finite non-commutative ring. Let us look at that. That is rather tricky. Example of finite and non-commutative ring. Well, we have seen some finite rings like this. We have seen one non-commutative ring. Do you remember one non-commutative ring that we saw? That was M2 of Z. Now, this ring is finite, but it is commutative. This ring is not commutative, but it is not finite. It is infinite because the elements can take all the values in Z. So how do you combine both the properties and get a finite non-commutative ring? Easy. Just take 2 by 2 matrices again, but the elements not in the whole of Z, let's take the elements in Z3 for example. So what does it mean? We want 2 by 2 matrices, but elements will be in Z3. What are the elements in Z3? 0, 1 and 2. So if you have matrices with entries or elements among these, how many matrices will you have? This place can be filled three times. This place can be filled three times. So for this and this, A, B, C and D, each one can take any of the three values. So what is the number of elements in this ring? What is the number of elements in this ring? I say the number is 3 raised to 4. That is 81. If you want a still smaller ring and you hope that it will be non-commutative, just take this. Again, 2 by 2 matrices, elements have got only two choices because Z2 is a set with only two elements. So, how many elements will be in this ring? They will be 2 raised to 4. That is only 16. Okay? So, I want you now to write down the elements of this. There will be 16 and you can find elements A and B, capital A and capital B, that is the matrices, so that AB is not equal to BA. Or even if you don't enumerate all the 16 elements, 16 members of this ring, you can still find out 2 by 2 matrices which do not commute with each other. Okay? I want to leave that to you and I want you to find out matrices in these rings, either this one or this one, so that AB is not equal to BA and you will have found the example asked in number 1, problem number 1.